MedCram.
Okay, well, welcome to another MedCram lecture. We were just talking about asthma in our first lecture, about the causes, the pathophysiology, where exactly this is happening. This is happening in the small airways. There's many different causes for asthma. Some people just have asthma just because of the air they breathe and the genetic makeup that they have. But there are things that can actually mimic asthma and set it off. And if you get rid of these things, you can make it better. So like things like GERD, gastroesophageal reflux disease, postnasal drip. Some people even have a condition associated with Sanfter's triad where they take an aspirin or an NSAID of some sort like ibuprofen or Aleve, and this can cause the patients to actually get set off in an asthma exacerbation. So things to look out for. What we're going to talk about today, though, is the diagnosis in this lecture. So asthma is a clinical diagnosis. The type of things that you might hear about in patients are patients who say, you know, when they breathe cold air, they suddenly get a tightness in their chest and it's hard to breathe. They may wheeze. Maybe exercising, because they're exercising, the air that's moving through their lungs is moving so quickly that it can't be warmed. And so the air inside the bronchus is cool enough so that it's going to actually cause inflammation and constriction. Other things that can cause asthma is just an allergy to food. That can cause them to get it. So these type of symptoms of wheezing, chest tightness, episodic after they do things, or if they smell different types of perfume, or if they're around someone with cigarette smoke, this should make you think of asthma. But how do we make a numeric diagnosis? We can do something called pulmonary function tests. And if there's any questions on that, please refer to our pulmonary function test lectures. The thing about pulmonary function tests, though, that may be misleading is, of course, that asthma is reversible. So sometimes it's bad, sometimes it's good. So if you schedule a patient for a pulmonary function test and they're asthmatic, you just don't know it yet, and they go in and they're having a good day, well, the pulmonary function test may just come out as being normal. So then what do you do? Well, it's also possible that it might come out to be abnormal and it may show obstruction. And from our lectures, you know that obstruction is where you have an FEV1 divided by FEC of less than 0.7. That's also the definition for COPD. The nice thing about COPD, ironically, in that case, is that COPD doesn't get better. So it doesn't matter when you get their pulmonary function test, it's always going to be less than 0.07. But because this has reversible airway inflammation and obstruction, it's possible that you could send the patient in, they're having a good day, and they've got a normal pulmonary function test. Well, if that's the case, you do a provocative test at that point. That provocative test, you're provoking the small airways to see whether or not they're reactive in nature. And the name of that test is called a methacholine challenge test. So that's methacholine challenge. And that's where we have patients breathe in a concentration, very small concentration, of methacholine. Now, you should know choline, it's an analog of a muscarinic agonist. And you, as you recall from our first lecture, if you stimulate the smooth muscle with choline or acetylcholine or a muscarinic agonist, you're going to get constriction. Usually, if a normal person were to breathe in a methacholine concentration, nothing should happen. But if they constrict and their airways get smaller, that is suggestive that they have reactive airways disease, or in this case, asthma. And let me kind of plot for you what this looks like. So if we were to graph this and we were to plot FEV1 here on the y-axis and arbitrarily set this to 100%, that's what the patient can do. And then what we do here is we do different trials. Okay, here we do a control, and of course the patient, by definition, is always going to breathe at 100% of their first try. And then what we start to do is we start to use a very small concentration, like let's say 1 to the 16th concentration of methacholine, and we keep going, 1 to the 8th, 1 to the 4th, 1 half, 1 concentration. And we see what happens. Now, in a normal patient, you're going to really not much have much change at all. Okay, so this is what they would look like. This is a patient without asthma, without reactive airways disease. However, in a patient with asthma, depending on if it's very reactive or not so reactive, let's pretend that they, in this case, are very reactive. You might see something like this. Okay, and if they weren't very reactive, let's say they were mildly reactive, you might see something like this. Okay, now the line I didn't draw for you at the beginning was the 80% mark, because that's the key. That's what determines when we stop this test. So clearly here, in the very reactive patient, going from 1 to 16 to 1 to 8, we crossed the line at this point. And so when that were to happen, we would have reached a reduction by about 20% in FEV1 or more, and the patient would then show reactivity. So it's a positive test at that point. The next thing we would do, of course, is instead of giving 1 to 4 concentration, we would give them a beta agonist like albuterol, and it would go back up. This V shape on a methacholine is suggestive and very indicative of reactive airways disease. Same thing for this patient. We would do the same thing. Now, the purple versus the blue. The purple reacted earlier in the test, meaning this patient is more reactive. The blue reacted later in the test, meaning less reactive but still reactive. The yellow is the one who never reacted. So the purple and the blue would both be diagnosed with reactive airways disease. And again, this is a methacholine challenge test. Okay, let's talk about the treatment of asthma. Okay, so since asthma is a reactive disease, before we even start talking about medications, we got to start looking at what may be causing it. So I want to spend a little bit of time here, because if you just skip to the medication part, you could be overlooking something that you might be able to get rid of, because medicines have side effects, especially if you're going to be putting this patient on a medication for a long period of time. You want to make sure that you're not giving them medication that they don't need. So you need to remove causes. And I alluded to this earlier, but some of the things that I would definitely look at is down comforters, down pillows. So these are down feathers you're putting up right next to your nose, right next to your face. You're sleeping with it and you're staying for it for 6 or 7 hours a night. Definitely want to consider that. Putting a mattress cover on. Pets that sleep with you. Okay, sometimes you're allergic to the pets. Getting them out of the bedroom. Looking for other things that might, that you can control. You know, you can't control everything. There's pollen in the air, you can't control that. But these things in your environment you can control. So looking for those sorts of things. Looking for postnasal drip, treating that. The treatment for that is intranasal corticosteroids. Looking for gastroesophageal reflux disease. This is a big one. Don't underestimate how much gastroesophageal reflux disease-driven asthma there is out there. The treatment for GERD is making sure the patient is elevated when they go to sleep at night, making sure they don't eat anything 3 hours before they go to bed, making sure they're avoiding spicy foods, avoiding alcohol, caffeine, cigarettes, that sort of thing. So I can't stress enough, looking for the underlying cause, because this is a reactive disease and we really need to make sure that we're eliminating that. Once you've done that, let's talk about pharmacotherapy. Okay, so everybody is going to get certain types of medications, and the one that everyone's going to get is a SABA, S-A-B-A. That's a short-acting beta agonist, specifically it's albuterol. Comes in many different forms. There is also, this is an enantiomer, there's a D and an L or an R and an S form. The other one that you will see is levalbuterol. Okay. There's many different brand names for albuterol. There's ProAir, there is Ventolin, there is Zopanex, which is the brand name for levalbuterol. Everybody needs to carry one of these around with them wherever they go, and they need to be educated on that, because you never know when an asthma exacerbation is going to hit, and they need to make sure they've got a rescue inhaler with them. Now, there's always a debate, meter dose inhalers versus nebulizers. There's really no difference between these two. The MDIs, which are the meter dose inhalers, are actually easier to carry around. The nebulizers, you've got to have power for. Some people can't activate the MDIs, and so in those cases, I don't have a problem giving nebulizers. These are the things that people use on a as-needed basis. So if they have an exacerbation, they can use it. It's usually prescribed up to every 4 to 6 hours, 2 puffs, that type of thing. So everybody gets one of these things, no matter how severe their asthma is. If it's very mild, this may be enough. So if they're only having an exacerbation once or twice a week, or a flare-up, this may be all that they need. Now, if they're having difficulties with exercise, and they know exactly what it is that flares it up, then they can take this before they're about to do that exercise, and that would eliminate the need for it later. It's always better to treat before the problem comes than after. There is a distinction made between intermittent and persistent asthma. Intermittent is if it's 2 or less times per week. Okay? If that's the case, then this is all you need. If it's persistent, however, if you're having to use this albuterol inhaler more than 2 times per week, then it's persistent. At that point, we need to go to something higher. And we'll talk about that. Okay, so let's talk about these steps that are reported in terms of treatment, from 1 being the least severe all the way up to 6 being the most severe. And as we talked about, step 1 is the intermittent asthma, and so the SABA, or the short-acting beta agonist, is all that's needed. Once you have more than 2 exacerbations per week, because of the fact that you're having inflammation, that's the cornerstone there, you're going to start the patient, everybody gets a SABA, of course, but you're going to add an inhaled corticosteroid. And you could start this out at a low dose and go from there. So I'll say a low dose. When you get to step 3, if that's not working, and if the patient is still using this two plus times per week, then move on to the next step, which would be, of course, keep using that SABA if you have to, and use that low dose inhaled corticosteroid. So you can use low dose or medium dose. Okay, and these inhaled corticosteroids, by the way, are medications like fluticasone, mometasone, budesonide. These are all inhaled corticosteroids that come as packaged in many different marketing tools. You'll see Advair, you'll see Symbicort, you'll see Dulera. These are all inhaled corticosteroids as combinations. So you use the SABA, which is the albuterol. That's going to take care of your exacerbations. And then you want to add this inhaled corticosteroid to reduce the inflammation. And so you can either increase the dose to a medium dose, or at step 3, what you can do is you can add a LABA, L-A-B-A. And that's a long-acting beta agonist. Not a short-acting, but a long-acting. Now, I want to make a point here that's important. Their long-acting beta agonists are medications like salmeterol and foradil. Okay, formoterol and salmeterol. These are the 2 long-acting beta agonists. I want you to notice an important point. They may ask you about this and test you on a test regarding this, is that the LABA is always added to the inhaled corticosteroid. Never in asthma will we ever start a patient on a monotherapy with a LABA, a long-acting beta agonist, first before starting the inhaled corticosteroid. They have noticed, and there's some literature out there, that there are increased cardiac deaths when a patient is placed on just a long-acting beta agonist without an inhaled corticosteroid. So you can see as we step up, the LABA is always added to the inhaled corticosteroid. I think I made that point. Okay, step 4, of course, we're going to go back and continue the SABA. And we're going to probably be using an inhaled corticosteroid / LABA. Okay. The other thing you can add here as an alternative is this leukotriene receptor antagonist. That would be medications like montelukast or zafirlukast. These are medications like Singulair, Acalate. Those are the brand names for them. And remember what we talked about before, this medicine is actually very helpful if you know you're dealing with something like Samter's triad, where you've got nasal polyps and aspirin or NSAID sensitivity. These are medications that you could add at this point. And these are basically inhibiting the leukotrienes. When we get up to step five, then we're going up to SABAs. Of course, we always add the SABA. And the inhaled corticosteroid / LABA. But these are high-dose inhaled corticosteroids. So we're using very high dose in combination with your LABA. So you've got a low dose, a medium dose, and a high dose. Now, when you get up here to step five, there's another medication that I've alluded to that you could use. Remember, we talked about IgE in the first lecture. When these immunoglobulins are high, they could be driving the reaction. There's a medication called omalizumab, which is actually an antibody itself, which attacks the IgE antibody. Now, this is a very expensive medication. We don't use it very frequently, and we usually use it if nothing else is going to work. But that's another potential thing that we can use. And then finally, when you get up to stage six, you're using everything that we used before, but now you're putting the patients on oral prednisone, which we don't like to do. Now, let's talk about side effects briefly. SABA, these are the short-acting beta agonists, tachycardia. You have to watch out for a fast heart rate. Inhaled corticosteroids. These are inhaled corticosteroids. Even though they're being inhaled, there are some side effects that you have to be aware of. Osteoporosis. Pneumonia. And make sure your parents are aware of this. Also, you need to rinse mouth out after use because they can cause fungal infections on your tongue. The omalizumab, this has got a side effect of cancer, of lymphoma. So you definitely want to be having a conversation with your patients in terms of risks and benefits. The risk of cancer is pretty small. And you're going to use omalizumab if you've got a higher risk of death from asthma than you would from cancer, okay? So just be aware that you've got to always weigh the risks and benefits. Of course, oral prednisone increases your risk of osteoporosis, pneumonia, and fungal infections. But this is higher than inhaled corticosteroids because this is being given orally and it's getting into your system systemically. Okay, so that was an overview of asthma, the pathophysiology, causes, diagnosis, and treatment. Thanks for joining us.